Tēnā koutou katoa, ko Cheryl Pym toko ingoa. Hei kai mahi a hau ki te whariwananga o Otago me te tapuai rehua. Hi, I'm Cheryl Pym. I'm part of the Mauki Te Ako project, governed by Te Tapuai Rehua, and I'm employed by the University of Otago. Welcome to this podcast, which is a part of a series that unpacks the key curriculum concepts in technology education and support teacher professional learning and development. This episode covers the first part of technological modelling, and in this particular podcast we're going to cover what modelling is, how to support student understanding, the link between knowledge of modelling and the practices of modelling, how to differentiate between functional modelling and prototype and their purposes in the classroom, what's functional and practical reasoning, and part of this will be also continued in a section under NCA assessments for levels 1, 2 and 3 and how those step up across the curriculum level. So, supporting your student understanding. It's really crucial that your students know about modelling in a conceptual framework, its purposes, its types, the nature of the evidence it supplies and why one type of modelling is used and why it should be used in a particular situation to gain a certain type of information. So it's about what to use, when and why. So as students develop through the levels of the curriculum, students are becoming more exposed to a range of modelling practices and understand which to choose for what purpose. It also allows students to enable them to evaluate and make a decision about design decisions within the context of creating both conceptual designs and technological outcomes. It's really important that your students also know what to test and when to test it and what's important to test. So therefore it's purposeful testing and modelling, not testing for testing's sake. And I'll come back to this concept later. But before I go on, it would be useful you to take a minute to pause and to think about where and how do you explicitly teach about modelling? Not showing how to model, but the conceptual understandings. So you might like to turn this off for a moment and have a think about that, and then come back and review the rest of the information. So getting down to Tintex, what's modelling? There are two types of technological modelling, functional modelling and prototyping. Both of them are key to developing technological outcomes, and students need to understand what they are and the differences between these two different types of modelling. Modelling is used both in developmental and implementation phases of technological outcomes, and we'll come back to that when we talk about the difference between the two types of modelling. Modelling practices are important for your students to understand as well, because we do want them to be able to undertake modelling in their technological practice so that when they're developing a particular outcome, whether it be a conceptual design or a fully realised technological outcome, that they are able to undertake a range of different types of modelling. A model in its simplest sense is a representation of reality. It can be a simulation. It should assist students to identify potential and problem impact, as well as issues that might arise while they're actually undertaking their practice. So it could be as simple as something failing to function as it could, or actually causing damage if it is, in fact, implemented. The specific knowledge and skill-based we use in modelling practices are often quite peculiar, in particular to domain knowledge. So, for instance, we would create a 3D model or scale model in a materials sense, but we would make a toile or a garment scale size mock-up in textiles. It might be wireframes in a web development sense or a trial circuit diagram to communicate the ideas. So the media used and the types of procedures undertaken may vary not only in the stage of development, but also in the different discipline areas. So, audiences. The stakeholder feedback is really important, and when it's sought, it does influence what you do and how you do it. So the type of media and model used is really important. And I might just deviate here and say that if you're using surveys or tools to gather information from stakeholders, that it should be specific to the stakeholder grouping. It needs to be specific to the aspect that you're testing and not too generic, so that the student gets information that is potentially gives them a bit of a red herring. So they're asking questions relevant to the stage of development, the aspect they're testing, and also the stakeholder group that they're targeting. So if I was creating a web page for school, I'd be looking at a range of stakeholders from the principal to the board of trustees to the students, but I might actually ask them different questions about different parts of the website. So be very clear about what your students need to test. Progressively, as we get closer and closer to the actual prototype or the final outcome, the materials will become far more closely aligned and may even be made in the actual material, for instance, garments and resistant materials and food products. So functional modelling. Functional modelling's purpose is to test and communicate your design ideas, and it undertake ongoing testing of those design concepts and design ideas to ensure that design decision making during the development of the technological outcome is appropriate. So we're testing to mitigate, identify, mitigate, and manage risk. Testing is from any of your design ideas to a conceptual design to predict its probability that these ideas or design aspects may have the potential to be fit for purpose. And in actual fact, we need to be able to predict that a conceptual design has the probability rather than just a possibility that it will meet the brief's attributes and specifications and therefore be fit for purpose. Modelling provides evidence to justify those decisions. So questions like, is this going to function as I think it will? Will it be acceptable? Are all part of the functional modelling phase. So we're trying to make an informed prediction of possible and probable consequences of my outcome. So let's avoid problems, really. And we all know that in the classroom, we want to avoid wasting time and money as much as anything else. So sometimes we use different language to talk about functional modelling. It could be referred to as a test or a trial or even predictive modelling. And as I've mentioned before, we use different types of modelling in different discipline areas. So TWALs, mock-ups, scale models, 2D and 3D CAD sketching, preference testing, taste tests, circuit diagrams, wireframes, coding, paper web pages and storyboards, and targeted survey. So whatever it is that we're trying to find out, we will probably have some sort of functional model to help us test that. We test little bits, as in a design idea or concept for part of an outcome, as well as testing that conceptual design with regards to its physical and functional nature. And it needs to also keep thinking back to the brief and its issue and its context, so where is this actually being situated. We also explore and evaluate the design concepts from a range of perspectives so that we make those justifiable and defensible decisions as students move through to the higher level of level 6, 7, 8 of the curriculum. So students will be exploring in functional modelling both the technical feasibility and the social acceptability of parts of or whole parts of a conceptual design and identifying and managing risks. Functional modelling also provides an opportunity to reduce waste and encourage students to think about more environmentally appropriate and sustainable choices when they're creating an outcome. Not always easy in a classroom situation, but we're trying to get students to think widely about the impact of their outcomes. So really, the better the functional modelling, the more confidence we'll have that the actual outcome will be fit for purpose and result in fewer issues once it's implemented. So your students should be taking informed decision making around identification of risk and risk management. Let's avoid the problem before we get there. Prototyping, on the other hand, is where we move past the conceptual design stage and we start developing things that are becoming closer and closer to the actual outcome. Generally, prototyping in a school setting is creation of a one-off outcome where we test and evaluate it in situ, and it's intended social and physical environment. We don't have the luxury in schools to actually go through three or four prototyping stages like they do in industry, but what we have is a completed outcome in the actual materials, and it functions as it should, as it's intended in its out, in its environment, and tested by those who will be using it or impacted by it. So the decisions as a result of modelling at this phase may actually include the termination of a development. So as we're moving through, it may become more and more obvious that this particular outcome, through functional modelling and even at a prototype stage, that it may not be fit for purpose and require some refinement. So, in summary, prototyping is the modelling of a realised but yet to be fully implemented tech outcome. So it's not yet gone into production, but it's the one-off. We need to evaluate its fitness for purpose against the brief in its intended location by the people who are going to use it and gain that feedback and evaluation to inform any further decisions about acceptability or change and improvement. Decisions for this stage in industry often is a no-go decision because they've found that it hasn't actually met the need or the brief, and this will lead to a revise and a design concept. But the other option in industry, and you may do this if you're looking at manufacturing with your students, that we have a prototype created for the purpose of testing the scale up. How can I actually go forward into multi-unit and marketing for a commercial purpose? So getting close to the end here, we're actually thinking about why technological modelling is important, and it's used to inform our decision making. It looks at risk management, identifying the risk, managing them, mitigating them, or even if the risk is there, we retain it because it's minimal. But there may be some strategies employed around that. So it really is about students undertaking modelling knowledge, using modelling knowledge and practices to evaluate whether outcomes are going to be fit for purpose. Final word on reasoning and decision making. Technological modelling is about two types of reasoning, functional and practical reasoning. Functional reasoning is about its technical feasibility of a design concept and the outcome, and practical reasoning is around social acceptability, the moral, ethical, social, political, economic, and environmental aspects of an outcome. I avoid using should and could when I'm talking to students because this is clouding the water for them at NCA. I always use technical feasibility and social acceptability up to year 10, and then move into functional practical reasoning as I see fit in the senior school. It is not a term that's used in the senior assessments, but the concept of technical feasibility and social acceptability is something kids can really grasp in a context that they're familiar with. So this is a bit of a snapshot. I hope it's given you a clear view of functional modelling and prototyping. Once you've reviewed your practices, you may like to go back and review this PowerPoint, the discussion, and really look at where and how you teach about modelling and support students to undertake modelling in your program. Nō reira, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa.